bent, losing sleep, and I homie need to preach. Whoa, name a place you wanna be, since the clock gonna die, about to give it to the king. Gotta do it for the tickets, gotta do it for my team. Whoa, what it do, y'all need chosen ones on the team. What you mean, I'm free, hey, keep the same energy. Tell your fam where to meet, eating good, where to meet. Whoa, tryna stay up out the heat, everybody wanna live. Man, I know how it is, but we got a couple skills that we wanna reveal. How to be the real deal, get the keys to the ride. It's the word of God, only means to survive. Vibe, vibe, vibe. Yeah, devil try to fill me with lies, so I pull up with the guys with the wings and the fries and the wings just to fly. Killing that flesh, what you mean I'ma die? Jesus be a force, so I lean on my guy. We about to go live, whole team on the sideline now. Yeah, Saturday nights, we in the spot. See all the lights, we give to God. Right now, it's our time. Right now, it's our time. Can't pipe down, it's our time. It's our time, yeah. You know this, everything holy, everything glowing. This that chosen flow. No, know this, everything holy, everything glowing. This that chosen flow. Focus, gotta stay focused, cause I'm still growing. Give me that Holy Ghost. Focus, gotta stay focused, cause I'm still growing. Give me that Holy Ghost. Chosen flow, oh my God. Chosen flow, I can't stop. Chosen flow, with my squad. Chosen flow, I can't stop. All the lights, we give to God. Right now, it's our time. Right now, it's our time. Can't pipe down, it's our time. It's our time, and you know this, everything holy, everything glowing. This that chosen flow. No, know this, everything holy, everything glowing. This that chosen flow. Focus, gotta stay focused, cause I'm still growing. Give me that Holy Ghost. Focus, gotta stay focused, cause I'm still growing. Give me that Holy Ghost. Chosen flow, oh my God. Chosen flow, I can't stop. Chosen flow, with my squad. Chosen flow, I can't stop. Saturday nights, we in the spot. See all the lights, we give to God. Right now, it's our time. Right now, it's our time. Can't pipe down, it's our time. It's our time.
Rethink Church.
Rethink Church.
You know this, everything holy, everything glowing. This that chosen flow. No, know this, everything holy, everything glowing. This that chosen flow. Focus, gotta stay focused, cause I'm still growing. Give me that Holy Ghost. Focus, gotta stay focused, cause I'm still growing. Give me that Holy Ghost. Chosen flow, oh my God. Chosen flow, I can't stop. Chosen flow, with my squad. Chosen flow, I can't stop.
We got another one now. Good evening, Chosen. Are you excited about being here? When day was done, I knelt to pray and prayed, dear Lord, bless everyone. Lift from the saddened heart the pain and let the sick be well again. Then I rose another day and carelessly went on my way. The whole day long, I did not try to wipe a tear from any eye. I did not even go to see the sick man just next door to me. Yet when day was done, I knelt to pray and prayed, dear Lord, bless everyone. Lift from the saddened heart the pain and let the sick be well again. And as I prayed, into my ear there came a voice that whispered clear, pause, hypocrite. Whom have you tried to bless today? Don't you know that God's greatest gifts come by those who serve him here below? And then I hid my face and cried, forgive me, Lord, for I have lied. Just let me live to see another day. Then I will live just as I pray. I want you to know that gathering here is not for form or fashion. It ought to make a difference in your life. I want to be here on Saturday evenings because every time I come, if through the fellowship or through the singing and praise or through the message, in some way God speaks to me and begins to transform my life, I want you to know that I'm a better man today than I was this time last week because of the worship experience that we shared together. And it's my prayer today that as we gather, that you'll allow God to do something for you. God is in this place. And I'm going to pray now to welcome him and his presence here. And as I pray, would you open your heart to God? Would you talk to him? I want you to know that you don't have to have the title pastor or clergy or worship leader for God to hear you. And if you would open your heart to him, as I pray audibly, God is listening to the silent prayers of your heart. As a matter of fact, if you would just kind of extend your arms just to say, God, I welcome you into not just this building, but we welcome you into this place and into our lives. Whatever may block or hinder the blessing that you intend for us, move it out of the way right now. We are open to receive what you will give us. We are thankful and grateful that you think enough of us, that you would spend time with us every Saturday evening in this place. And so we welcome you today. We welcome you and we anticipate what you're going to do for your children. We give you praise. We give you honor. Dear God, we give you all the glory. And right now, we're going to take our hands and put them together and give you praise in the form of a hand clap. We're going to say thank you in advance for what you're about to do in the powerful name, the almighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Expect your blessing. I want to share just a few announcements before Chosen to Worship leads us in song. I want to remind our MIT that our next MIT event is November the 14th, Sunday, November 14th. And if you want to be a part of that event, text MIT event to the number that's on the screen. Text MIT event to the number that's on the screen. Now, next Saturday, we're going to have another opportunity for folk to be baptized and to join this fellowship. That's right. And if you want to be a part of that experience, we want you to be a part of it. We're going to ask that you text PURPOSE to the number that's on the screen. You see it there, 706-725-4902. If you text PURPOSE, that gives us an indication that you want to be a part of that special experience where you become a part of God's family and a part of the Chosen family. And then last but not least, who knows what's happening next? Is it next? No, tomorrow. Tomorrow. Who knows what's happening tomorrow? What's happening tomorrow? Not the little C, it's the what? Big C, the Big C tomorrow, and you see the information on the screen. If you don't know how to get there, it's downtown Augusta on the river. If you would just put in your GPS, Boll Weevil. Put Boll Weevil in your GPS, that's a restaurant. If you can get to the Boll Weevil, you can get to the outdoor amphitheater, and we want to see as many of our Chosen family there to join with True North and to join with, is it Vision? Visible. Yes, with True North Invisible, and have the big, the big, the big, the big. That's tomorrow. We're going to look forward to seeing you there. Are you ready for God to bless you? Well, we're going to give you that blessing now.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory be to God. Glory be to God, chosen. How are y'all this evening? Y'all all right? Let everything that have breath praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We thank God because he is able to do everything exceedingly and abundantly above all we can ask or think. He is able to do. He can make a way. Whatever your situation is tonight, God can make a way. He is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he will repent. If he said he'll do it, he'll do it. Hallelujah.
Yeah. You made a way. Yeah. Don't know how, but you did it. You made a way. Standing here, not knowing how we'll get through this test.
Y'all can turn about.
But holding on to faith, you know best. Nothing can catch you by surprise. You've got this figured out, and you're watching us now. But when it looks as if we can't win, you wrap us in your arms and step in. And everything we need, you supply. You've got this in control, and now we know that you made a way.
Can you declare tonight? Yeah.
When our backs were against the wall,
what it looked like.
And it looked as if it was over, oh, you made a way. And we're standing here only because you made a way.
Yeah.
You made a way. And now we're here, looking back on where we've come from. Because of you and nothing we've done. And mercy you saw. Your grace was strong enough to lift us up. And you made a way.
When our backs were against the wall.
When our backs were against the wall.
And it looked.
And it looked as if it was all you made a way. And we're standing. And we're standing here. Only you move mountains, yeah. You close walls to fall with your power, yeah. You perform miracles, there is nothing, yeah, that's impossible. And we're standing here only because you made you move.
You move mountains,
yeah. You close walls.
With your power,
perform miracles.
There is nothing.
Yeah.
but you did it.
Yeah, yeah.
You made a way.
Don't know how, but you did it.
Don't know how, but you did it.
Yeah.
You made a way.
Don't know how, but you did it.
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 And everything between, God, you move mountains. You move mountains. Yeah, yeah. And you cause walls to fall. You cause walls to fall. You cause walls to fall. Declare today. You cause walls to fall. You cause chains to break. You cause chains to break. Cause he calls. Hallelujah. Give God glory today. Isn't that a blessing to know we don't have to worry? He makes the way. He said, cast your cares on me because I care for you. When people even tell me, take care, sis, I say, no, I cast my care. Hallelujah. I cast it to the one who can carry it. Hallelujah. Hey, hey. Oh, oh, oh. Cause he's intentional, yeah, never failing. I know that all things are working for my good, yeah, cause he's intentional, yeah, never failing.
All things are working for my good,
cause he's intentional.
intentional.
He's intentional.
Yeah, and he's never failing.
Never failing.
Intentional,
yeah.
And he's never failed.
Never failed.
All things
are working for my good.
Said all things are working for my good.
All things are working for my good.
Said all things are working for my good. All things are working for my good. It's working for me. It's working for me. And I declare it's working for me. Yeah, yeah. I don't have to worry, cause it's working for me. Yeah, it's working for me. And I believe it's working for me. Tell the people, I don't have to worry.
I don't have to worry. It's working for me.
It's working for me.
It's working for me.
On a war cry. Yeah. Hallelujah. Declaring today that all things are working for my good. It may look crazy, but all things are working for my good. Yeah. You might be in a relationship and hubby might be speaking all this. It's working for my good. You might be in a relationship and wifey is speaking like this. It's working for my good. Let's speak those things that be not as though they were. Hallelujah. Let's stand on the word of God. Hallelujah. It's the word that makes the difference. It's the word that incorruptible seed. Plant those seeds, hallelujah. We don't have to worry today, hallelujah. Amen. Let's go. Hallelujah.
Hey, Nessa had a word tonight. I was gonna let her do her thing. Hey, I love it. I love it. We got an all-star team at Chosen. Oh my goodness. I feel like the Brooklyn Nets before Kyrie decided he didn't want to play. It don't matter who we put in the game. We got Durant, we got Kyrie, we got James Harden. It doesn't matter. Hey, I'm so thankful for what God is doing and for allowing us to be a part of it. Y'all need to be thankful because God could get it done without us. Amen. I'm so excited that he uses us as a part of his purposeful plan. This is your first time hanging out with us. I want to welcome you. My name is Unique Mackey. I am the pastor here at Chosen. I consider it a privilege to lead what I call CSRA's greatest group of people. We call ourselves Chosen. Our mission here is to gracefully guide people into their God-given purpose. If it is your first time, thank you for hanging out with us. Instagram, YouTube, Facebook, whether you're watching on our website, shout out to you. You are a part of our extended family. We want you to know that we have a resource for you on our website, chosencsra.org. If it's your first time, download that resource. It is a purpose plan for your life. If you go to that website, there's a free ebook that you can download and read that will help guide you into God's purpose for your life. So go to the website and check that out if you're watching online on one of our social media outlets. As I said, our mission is to gracefully guide you into your God-given purpose. We believe that everyone has a purpose and we need God's grace to walk in it. And we want to walk with you into God's purpose. I believe our care pastor alerted you to the big C tomorrow. And I didn't let him know, yes, if you have never been, you are in for a treat. I didn't tell him this, but I am letting you all know, because I hope that you can make it, that if you look at communion in the New Testament, there were times when they would take communion, and they wouldn't just take the communion, the bread and the wine, but they would also fellowship together. They would also have full meals. And so I thought it would be an awesome opportunity for me to be able to kick it with some of our chosen family. And so I want to let you know, if you're coming to hang with us at the Big C tomorrow, I will be taking everyone out to dinner afterwards. So that there'll be a free meal. I've already made a phone call to Pizza Joint. And so we'll be pre-ordering some pizzas and some salad for everybody. So as soon as we get done taking communion at the Big C, we will go over to the Pizza Joint off of Broad Street and we will break bread together as a chosen family. So again, I hope you can make it. That is when we'll be taking communion. I know you all are like, where's the communion? Because we usually do that on first or second Saturday. We'll be taking communion tomorrow with two of our partner churches. So please be there and enjoy worship and communion with us. This is the last message in a series called Living in Purpose. It's been a phenomenal series, and I'm so glad to see the impact that it's having on our church family. Today is the last message from that series, and next week I will start a new series. I'm switching it a little bit. The series I had planned, I'm going to postpone to the new year. So starting next week, we will begin a series called Heroes. Everybody say heroes. We will be learning about some of the unsung heroes in the Bible and what principles they use to become an unsung hero. We're going to learn from their life, and we're going to apply those principles to our life, because I want you to know that God has given you a gift that you can use to greatly impact and inspire others like the heroes of old. And so I can't wait to get into that series. But tonight, we'll be finishing up the Living in Purpose series with part two, Battle for Your Blessing. I want you all to know, if you're going to live in purpose, which is a life of power, passion, productivity, and peace, that it's going to be a battle. Purpose is something that God has for all of you. You've heard me say it before. I don't care how old you are. I don't care about where you're from. I don't care about your skin tone. I want you to know that regardless of how many mistakes that you have made, God has a plan and a purpose for your life. We call it the purpose print. Just like you have a fingerprint that identifies you, you have a purpose print that identifies you, you have a unique blend of gifts, talents, and upbringing. And when you submit that to God, he will use you for purpose. But it's a battle. And when you're in this spiritual battle, I want you to know that the enemy, Satan, the devil, he's coming for what I like to call the root. The root of a tree is the place where the tree begins to transfer the nutrients through the vascular system of the tree, and the tree begins to grow leaves and limbs and fruit. And we talked about how if you wanted to take away the possibility of fruit from this tree, you would be hustling backwards to come out every single day to cut the leaves, to cut the limbs, to cut the fruit. Because if you wanted to stop this tree from being fruitful and you only decided to take the fruit off and to cut the limbs and to cut the leaves, if you only decided to do that day after day after day after day, you would get tired of trying to disrupt the fruitfulness of the tree. But if you were wise, what would you do? That's right. You would go for the root. If you wanted to stop the fruit, you would go for the root. Well, what is the root? The root for us is our faith. The battle for your blessing is centered around your belief system. Young people, all eyes on me, listen up. You want to know why it's so hard for you to believe? It's because the devil is going for your root. You want to know why you struggle and you're sitting there in class and you're listening to what those teachers and those professors are saying and you're like, man, I grew up in church, but it doesn't seem like the culture is in line with what I've been taught. And so maybe it's not true. Let me tell you, it's true, but there's a battle for your belief system because the enemy knows if he can get to your root, he can get to your fruit. The devil is not after your stuff. He's after your mindset. We joked a couple weeks ago that you hear people, when they get a flat tire, they say, man, the devil is busy, but the devil isn't after your car. He's only after your car if you have faith in your car. Because if your faith is in your stuff, then he'll attack your stuff because your stuff is your root. He doesn't care about how much money you have or what you're driving or how many bedrooms you have. He only attacks the fruit of your life to try to get to the root of your life. This is why the devil said about Job, he said, if you take away his stuff, God, he'll curse you. What the devil was banking on is Job giving up his faith because of what he saw happening to his fruit. He said, God, if you touch his stuff, I bet you he won't believe. His hope was that Job's faith was in his fruit and not his heavenly father. And he's hoping that your hope is in your fruit instead of your heavenly father, because if he can touch your fruit, he can get to your root. If we are going to live in purpose, we need our roots deep in our faith. We need to have our faith and trust in what God has said and not what we see. Because if we allow the devil to take our root, he'll be taking our fruit. And so we see in Genesis a battle for the blessing. Genesis says that Adam was placed in purpose. It says that God blessed them. Let me tell you, if you're a child of God, you are blessed. And you don't have to chase dominion and purpose. It's a blessing from God. You don't have to scheme. You don't have to hustle. You don't have to lie. You don't have to steal. Because of your connection with God, because you were made in his image, fruit is a byproduct. It said God blessed them to take dominion. And then he took Adam and he placed Adam in the garden. That's why I said we don't have to chase purpose. If we chase God, he'll place us in purpose. You spend too much time chasing this job or chasing this career and switching cities and doing all this when maybe if you spend that energy chasing God, he placed you in some purpose. Genesis 2 says that. It says, and the Lord God commanded man, saying, you may surely eat of the tree of the garden, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. So I'm placing you in purpose. I'm placing you in blessing, but there's a boundary to the blessing. That if you want to leverage the blessing of God, you've got to obey the boundary. So I'm giving you all these other trees you can eat. If you're ever hungry, there's a lot that you can have, but there's only one thing that you can't. Why can't I have it all, God? Well, the reason you can't have it all, Unique, is because if you can have it all, there's no place for your faith. I'm going to set the tree in the middle of the garden because I want you to see it. And every time you see it and you say no, you're showing me your faith. Did you know that sometimes God will put some stuff in front of you just so you can say no? You running from the women not knowing that God's sending them so you can say no. You running. I know, ladies, it's hard. They after you, but sometimes it doesn't matter if you got your hair done, if you got your lashes done, whether you had your mani or your pedi. They gonna show up because God wants you to say no. Every time we say no to something we want, we're submitting our will to what God wants. Sometimes God will place stuff in the middle of your life and let you see it just to see if you'll choose it or him. How could man show faith if there was nothing he couldn't touch? Some people trip over that. Well, God, that was setting man up for sin. God wasn't setting man up for sin. God was setting man up for faith, and we chose sin. I have got to put something in your life that you can't touch so that you can choose to love me more than you love stuff. Every day you wake up, I want you to choose me. There'll be other stuff you can do, and I want you to choose me. There'll be other places you can go. I want you to choose me. There'll be stuff that you want to touch that you know you shouldn't, and I want you to choose me. I'm not putting it there so you can sin. I'm putting it there so you can say yes to me. I put you in the garden to work it and keep it. That word keep is protect. That right there should have been a setup for Adam to know that even though I'm in a place of purpose, I've got to protect what God has given me. You don't just work it, you got to keep it. Holler at me, men, real quick. We don't have a problem with the work. Most of the time, we have a problem with the keeping. We'll focus so much on the work that we won't keep what God has given us. We'll provide for the family, but here's the question. Are you protecting it? So here it is. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, you may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For the day that you eat of it, you shall surely what? Die. So Eve gets into a conversation, and this is where the battle is starting. Because he's planting a seed of doubt, because the battle is over her belief system. He said, if I can just get to the bottom of why she does what she does. Why has she been saying no to this tree every day that she sees it? She's saying no to this tree every day she sees it because she has such a deep faith in God. So I need to go for her roots. Because every bit of our behavior is connected to some sort of belief system. That's got why you have to watch what you believe. That's why you have to watch who you let speak into your life, because they're helping you form a belief system. So he makes her doubt God's word. I'm not going to go back. If you missed it, go back 2 weeks on the Facebook or the YouTube channel and check that out. But that's where we left off. And not only did he get her to doubt God's word, he got her to doubt God's consequence. Here it is. It says that you won't surely die. Did God actually say, doubting God's word? And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the midst of the garden, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. Genesis 3:3. It says that put Genesis 3:3 up for me. There it is. But the serpent said to the woman, you will not surely die. For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. Don't miss it. This is key. All eyes on me. First, he tries to get us to doubt God's word. Then he tries to get us to doubt God's consequences. God said you were going to die, but that's not what's going to really happen. Your parents said don't do it and you'll be punished, but that's not what's going to really happen. God said wait until marriage before sex, but because it's going to be dangerous if you don't, but that's not what's really going to happen. God will tell you things that's not true, Eve. You can't really trust what God says. He says there's going to be consequences, but it's not. I love Galatians. It says, God will not be mocked because a man will reap what he sows. I love Galatians. It says, God will not be mocked. What that means is God will not be made fun of. Do you know when you think that you can get away with something that God says you won't get away with, it's like making fun of him? It says God is not going to be made fun of. You will reap whatever it is you sow. Whew. Watch this. You can learn how things in the spiritual realm work based on how things in the physical realm work. Oftentimes what we see in the physical is a representation of what's happening in the spiritual. When God created the earth, there's a scripture in Genesis that says that God causes everything to reproduce according to its what? Own kind. Did you ever think about that? That why fish can only have fish, and why cows can only have other cows, and when you plant an apple seed, it only grows an apple tree, or when you plant a strawberry seed, you only get strawberries and not grapes, or when you plant for grapes, you only get grapes, not oranges. That is a law of nature. God said that when you plant something, the only thing that can come back is that which you've planted. So when he says, God won't be mocked, man will reap what he sows, what he's really saying is that there's a law of reproduction at work that you can't break. So if you sow bitterness, you'll only get back bitterness. If you sow selfishness, you can only get back selfishness. Why? Because I've caused everything to reproduce according to its own kind. Why do you think you can plant one thing and get something else back? That's the problem with some of our marriage. We're planting hate and we're getting back, and we're planting hate thinking we should get back love. No, you can only reproduce according to what you sow. So don't think that your spouse is going to love you if you're not loving them. God is not mocked. For whatsoever one sows, that will he also reap. Don't let the devil trick you into thinking that God is not serious about what you sow. So here Eve is trying to fight for her purpose, and the devil's hit her with a slick two-piece. Not only can't you trust his word, you don't have to worry about his consequences either. You can sow disobedience and still get purpose, Eve. Eve, don't worry about what God is saying. Trust me. So he gets her to doubt God's word, then he gets her to doubt God's consequences, and then he gets her to doubt God's love. Because he says, Eve, God knows that when you eat of the fruit of that tree, you're going to be like him. So now she's doubting God's intentions. He's not withholding something from Eve for her betterment. He's holding something from Eve because if she touches it, she'll be like him. Do you know that when you disobey God because you don't trust him, what you're actually telling God is, you really don't love me? You're telling me that that person isn't good for my life, not because you love me, but because you don't. You're telling me that this isn't the right career for me, not because you want me to live in purpose, but because you don't want me to live in purpose. God, you're really keeping something from me, not for my betterment, but for my destruction. He gets Eve to doubt God's intention for the boundary. Young people, you can testify to this. Has your parent ever told you something and you were angry about the boundary? Mommy, you just don't want me to have fun. What you're doing when you say that is you're telling your mom or your dad that they don't love you. Because when you love somebody, you always do your best to do what's best, not for you, but for them. So God
God is keeping this tree from Eve, not because he doesn't love her, but because he does. Eve, I don't want you to touch that tree because it's the knowledge of good and evil. If you touch that tree, yes, what the devil said, part of it is true. You will know good from evil, but what the part that he's not telling you is that you can't handle it. See, that's the thing about a good liar. A good liar always cuts a lie with a little bit of truth. A professional liar will sprinkle just enough truth in it to cover up the lie. So part of what the devil is saying is true. If you eat of the tree, you will get the knowledge that God has. But here's what the devil hasn't said, is that that knowledge won't help you. It'll hurt you. See, a good leader will always keep things from the people that are following them that he knows that they can't handle. So your parents are telling you no because they know you can't handle what you want to know. God is telling you no because he knows that you can't handle what you're trying to get into. So he says, Eve, trust me. Yeah, if you eat it, you will have the same knowledge that I have, but you can't handle it because you're not me. Do you know that whatever God says is his, he's the only one that can handle it? You want to know one of the top reasons I give? It's because I don't know what to do with that 10%. That's God's. That's extra that I don't need. It's God's. If God says don't touch it, he's telling us don't touch it because you can't handle it. If you leave it, if you let me have it, I'll take you further without it than you could go with it. So Eve, I'm telling you don't touch the tree. Because I'll take you further with your faith and trust in me than you could with the knowledge that will come from the tree. Don't touch it, Eve. Eve, you can't handle the knowledge of good and evil, because once you know what's out there, you're going to want it even more. There's some stuff you're just not supposed to know because it's going to alter your decision making. Singles, you want to know that's the number one reason we do conferences like Let's Talk About Sex. It's because when God says wait until marriage for sex, he's saying it because if you have sex, you're going to have an intimate knowledge of a person that you shouldn't have. So when you're thinking about who you ought to marry, you're using things that, to make that decision that you ain't even supposed to know about. Woo! Preach, Mackie. I think I will. You making a decision about your life and marriage using data that you're not supposed to have yet. They good in the bed, but are they good standing up? Don't make your decisions based on 1% of your life. Yeah, it may be good with the 1%, but if they stink at the 99, whoo, listen, I'll moonwalk on that one. Woo-hoo. She said no. So here's what he does. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, he was appealing to her appetite. And here's the thing about appetites. We talked a little bit about this last week. The appetite in and of itself is not sin. What makes an appetite sinful is what you choose to fulfill your appetite. So Eve, the appetite is not sin, but if you eat something I told you not to touch, it is. It's nothing wrong with having a certain appetite. What makes it wrong is how you choose to fill it. Are you going to fulfill that appetite for money outside my will for your life? A drug dealer has an appetite for money. It's not sin until he hits the block and starts selling drugs. It's nothing wrong with wanting to make money. What makes it wrong is when you do something outside of God's will to fulfill the appetite. There's nothing wrong with an appetite for food. It only turns into sin is when we start eating more of it than we should. I knew y'all weren't gonna like that. So Eve, I'm not tripping that you want to eat. I'm just tripping that you want to eat something I told you not to touch. I'm tripping, Eve, because you letting the enemy chop at your root right now. Nowhere did you come back to me and ask, was this okay? No time did you pause and pray. No time did you seek counsel. You making all these decisions because of discussion with the devil. I wonder how many of us could testify that I've been in some discussions with the devil and I didn't want anybody to know. I'm not praying about it because I already know what I want to do. I'm not asking for counsel because I don't want nobody to talk me out of this. I see the fruit and I've already made up in my mind. There's nothing you can say to me that's going to keep me from touching what God said don't touch. I'm not coming in for counseling you need. I had people send me an email that said, I don't want to talk. Why? Because they already had their mind made up. And I appreciate that. Don't waste my time. Amen. If I can't help you, leave me alone. God bless you. So we have to be careful, family, because there's a part of me that doesn't want purpose what? For me. And so I've got an appetite that's not in and of itself sin, but then there's another part of me that I have to be careful of. And then he appeals to her emotion. And that it was a delight to the lady. She saw it and it looked good. It brought delight. Also, now he's working on an appetite and emotion. That's a dangerous combination. It's something she wants, appetite, and it's something that makes her feel good because of how it looks. So now the devil cooking with gas. Oh, I got her now. She wants it, and it's making her feel good. He wants it, and it's making him feel good. But he didn't have her here. There was one last step. He started with the appetite. Then he hit her with the emotion. Then he hit her with ego. And that the tree was to be desired to make one wise. Now, if the devil can get at your appetite, and if the devil can get it to your emotion, and the devil can get to your ego, you might as well wrap it up. Eve, it's gonna fulfill your appetite, it's gonna make you feel good, and you're gonna feel better about yourself after you do it. Eve, it's going to make you wise. Eve, you always know you wanted to be wiser. Eve, you know that you wanted to be popular. Eve, you know you always wanted this extra power. Eve, you know you always wanted this extra money. So what the devil will do is he'll give you an opportunity to fulfill your appetite, fulfill your emotion, and fulfill your ego. Whew. If you want to live in purpose, you got to pray that God protect your appetites, that God will protect your emotion, and that God will protect your ego. Because even the devil knows that God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. If you are proud, God will always be fighting against you in your relationships. If you're proud in your career, God will always be fighting against you. If you're proud in your home, God will always be fighting against you, because he has to push back against pride. But here's the other side of it. He'll give grace to the humble. If I submit my will to what God wants, he'll give me grace. If I submit my emotions to God in faith, then God will bless me. God will make sure I'm living a life of purpose. But here it is. If I let my ego guide me, it's a battle for your blessing. And I'm telling you what he's using. He's using your appetites. He's using your emotions. And he's using your ego. This is a recipe for destruction. I almost guarantee you 9 out of 10 marriages end because of this: appetite, emotion, and ego. I'm a grown man. I got an appetite. And she ain't gonna be talking to me like that and ignoring me. And this other lady make me feel real good. She's a delight to the. And my appetite isn't fulfilled. And she tells me how handsome I am. JT said, don't do it. It's a recipe. Now watch what happens. Eve takes the fruit and she eats of it. And she gives some to her husband. And he hits and he eats of it. Adam was right there. That's why I call him apathetic Adam. I'm not going to get too deep into this, because I'm going to talk a little bit about this in my hero series. Adam was right there. That's why I call him apathetic, because an apathetic man will let their family play with evil and play along with them. An apathetic man does not protect his family. He helps in perverting it. He's right there. And God, remember, he said, Adam, I want you to work this land and I want you to protect this land. And he's sitting there, he's working it, but there was no protection. Most men have no problem providing. Our problem is the protection. Most men have no problem with the finances. Our problem is the family. Why? Because the finances brings you pride, and when your family is what should make you look good. It doesn't matter how much money I make if my family doesn't look good. So Adam is right there, and instead of stepping in and saying, honey, what's this discussion about? Honey, what's going on here? Are you okay? Why are you having this discussion with the devil? Do we need to pray about it? Instead of him stepping in, he sits right there, and he eats the same fruit she does. Apathetic. Genesis 3:23-24 says, therefore, the Lord God sent him out from the Garden of Eden to work the ground from which he was taken. After sending them out, the Lord God stationed mighty cherubim to the east of the Garden of Eden. And he placed a flaming sword that flashed back and forth to guard the way of the tree of life. Watch this. Adam and Eve sinned, and when they sinned, as God said, they would die. Die means separation. They separated from God spiritually. Now, physical death didn't happen for Adam until over 900 years after he sinned. Why did the physical take 900 years when the spirit happened instantaneously? But it's because physical always follows spiritual. So the evidence of their disconnection from God didn't really show up fully until 900 years after they sinned. So because of their disconnect from God, they began to hide from him instead of fellowshipping with him. Oftentimes, that's how you know somebody's in sin. They don't want to fellowship anymore. They came every week, now they come once a month. They disconnected from the thing that represented God, the thing that was God. And they covered themselves with leaves. Because now they had the knowledge of good and evil. So they're looking at themselves trying to cover up what used to be pure to them. But what I love is that when God saw that they had separated, he went looking for them. Oh, y'all don't know when to get excited. I thought that y'all would clap on that. When you were separated from God, he went looking for you. Let me try this side, Shalonda. When you were separated from God, when you had disobeyed, he went looking for you. Romans 5:8 says, God demonstrates his love in this, that when we were yet sinners, Christ died. Is anybody beside myself glad that Christ didn't wait until I got it together to come looking for me? He came when I was a sinner. He came when I was at the club. He came when I was high and drunk. He came when I was sleeping around. He came when I was greedy. He came when I was thirsty. He came. Watch. So he sees that they can't properly cover themselves. And the Bible says that God took skin and covered them. Pull that down. I'm not dead yet, Jay. You one step ahead of me. Listen. Skin. What's the difference between skin and leaves? Leaves have no life. You can't cover yourself with something that has no life. That's why you're depressed now, because you're trying to cover yourself with something that has no life. That blunt won't pull you out of depression. That bottle won't pull you out of depression. That young lady you like won't pull you out of depression. That ugly boy you begging today won't pull you out of depression. The only thing that will pull you out of death is some life. So he cut the skin off of... So sleepy. He says, look at these pathetic people trying to cover themselves. Anytime you try to cover yourself, it's pathetic. You can't cover your own sin. How can a sinner fix a sinner? Eve and Adam, y'all were the problem. How you gonna be the solution? Stop trying to cover yourself. If you are part of the problem, how can you be the part of the purpose? Stop trying to fix yourself. So he says, watch this. I got to kill something. I need something with some blood. So he took an animal and killed it. I always tell you that the Old Testament is the New Testament concealed, and the New Testament is the Old Testament revealed. He killed something pure in the garden as a pause, as a stopgap before he would send his son that would cover all sin. So he said, until I send my son, I'm just going to cut this animal, and this blood is going to have to deal with. Hold on. So he kills it,
yes, sir.
And he covers it.
Yes, sir.
That represents God's grace. Because remember, Eve, I said the day you eat of the fruit, you shall surely die. But that's only physically. You don't have to die eternally for your sin. So, yeah, you're going to die physically, but you won't die eternally because I'm going to kill this animal and I'm going to use this animal's blood to cover you because it's my blood that covers all sin. Yeah, there is a physical consequence, but that doesn't mean it has to be eternal. So I'm going to cover you with something that has some blood. You were supposed to be the one that died, but I'm gonna kill something else. That's why every time I mention the cross, y'all should go crazy, because it was us that was supposed to die, but God chose to kill something else. Is there anybody besides myself that is glad that he sent his son? That was us that was supposed to be on that cross. That was us that was in lust. That was us that was in pride. That was us who let our appetites guide us. But God said, instead of killing you, I'm gonna kill something else. So I'm going to cover you. Hebrews says that only through the remission of sin, the spreading of blood, only that can lead to the remission of sin. So until blood was shed, you still in your sin, Eve. So I know you think you were cute with that little leaf skirt, but the leaf has no life. You still in sin. Even if it was a little Gucci leaves, Louis leaves, it wouldn't have mattered. Why? Because it has no life. Isn't it funny how we try to dress up sin? It doesn't matter how cute you are if you're carnal. Eve, that leaves may look cute, but you're still carnal. Why? Because there's been no shedding of blood. So watch what happens. It says that he kicked them out the garden. So there was a consequence. There's always a consequence for sin. Because God will not be mocked. A man will reap what he sows. Everything reproduces according to its own kind. So there has to be a consequence. So I've got to kick you out of that place of purpose because of your disobedience. So things aren't going to go right because you're not obedient. Your marriage won't go right because you're not obedient. The business won't go right because you're not obedient. What you're trying to accomplish won't be purposeful because you're not obedient. So I've got to kick you out because there has to be consequences to sin. But even though I kicked you out, here's the shouting part, you still covered. I may not be in the same place, but it doesn't matter because I still have some purpose left. I'm kicked out. I have to deal with the consequences. consequences of my choice, but I can still praise God because even though he kicked me out, I thank you, Lord, that I'm still covered. Even though I'm a sinner, God, thank you that you sent your Savior. God, I know that I have to deal with the consequences, but forget about them consequences. As long as you cover me, I'm still thankful. I'm kicked out, but I'm still covered. I may not be in the same place, but I still have some purpose. I was wrong, but God still redeemed me. I may have made some mistakes, but God will cover me. I love that. They didn't even have to ask for it. That's the grace. I know we like to be cocky as Christians. Well, yeah, God, I chose God. Let me help you. You didn't choose God. God chose you. I'm kicked out, but I'm still covered. Chosen to worship, join me on stage because I want to end this series with a powerful worship, a song that I think will minister to you. I want you to think about something that's very important, Chosen Family, and that is your purpose. We've ministered about purpose for the last 2 months. And I want you to think about where you are on your purpose journey. And whatever is holding you back, I want you to spend this time in worship, intentional about prayer surrounding that problem that's preventing your purpose. I don't care how holy you are. I don't care how long you've grown up in church. Everyone, including the man with the microphone, has an area of growth. So everybody needs to be praying. Everybody needs to be worshiping. If you don't feel like you can pray, somebody from our prayer team will meet you at the altar or meet you at the crosses. You're welcome to come up and pray. But listen, I want you to take this time seriously, because I believe God is shifting us as a ministry. And I want people who call themselves chosen to be living in purpose. When I see God, I don't want anybody who was called to be a part of my ministry to miss it. When I see God, I want to hear, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." Everybody that was called to be a part of that chosen movement, unique, they lived a life of purpose. They lived a life of passion. They lived a life of power. They lived a life of productivity. And we can all get in together. So whatever's holding you back, family, we're not going into 2022 with that mess, with that baggage, with that burden. We're going to give it to God.
Hallelujah.
And even though we may have been kicked out of some stuff, you still covered. Don't focus on the past. Let's focus on our present. Yeah, there may be some stuff that didn't work out the way that you planned. Maybe it was a marriage. Maybe it was a business. Maybe it's something with your kids. Maybe it was something with a ministry. I don't know what it is, and you may have been kicked out of it, but let me tell you, you're still covered. God's grace is still available to you. God's redemption is there even when you're wrong. He's given his son that whosoever would believe in him doesn't have to perish, but you can have everlasting life. And though there may be physical consequences to our choices, those physical consequences don't have to become eternal consequences. We may have been kicked out some physical stuff, but my eternity is good.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, God, we bless you. We give you honor. Like the pastor said, like Pastor Yannick said, if you're in need of prayer, please, there is someone there at the cross to meet you, to touch and agree with you for whatever you believe in God for. The altar is open. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. If I had my choice, I would choose you every time. I would choose you every time. If I had my choice, I would choose you every time. I would choose you every time. Because to worship you, I live. To worship you, I live. I live to worship you. If I had my choice, I would choose you every time. I would choose you every time. Oh, if I had my choice, I would choose you every time. I would choose you every time. Because to worship you, I live. To worship you, I live. I live to worship you. All in one voice, all in one voice. To worship you, to worship you, I live. To worship you, I live. I live to worship you. Hallelujah. To worship.
The world tried to show me. Hallelujah. And my trust was in money. The world tried to show me that I could do it on my own. The world tried to show me that you're not who you say you are. But now I know better. But now I know better. Hallelujah. But now I know better. Hallelujah. I know you are God. Yeah. I know you are God. Yeah, yeah. I know you are God. Yeah. To worship you I live.
To worship you I live.
To worship you.
To worship you I live. I live. To worship you.
To worship you I live. To worship you.
That's
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We only here to worship you. That's the only reason we were created. We here to worship.
I live to worship.
Come on, Chosen. We're not on the stage to sing by ourselves. To worship you. We live to worship.
I live to worship you.
Things about to change. Things can get better. To worship you. We live. The only reason we on this planet is for the purpose of worship. God, and we want to worship you in the way that we work. We want to worship you in the way that we date. We want to worship you in our career. We want to worship you in our ministry. We want to worship you with our money. We want to worship you with our marriage. We want to worship you in the way that we raise our kids. We want to worship you in the way that we serve in our community. We want to worship you in the way that we teach. We want to worship you in the way that we doctor at the hospital. We want to worship you the way that we work at the dentist's office. We want to worship you the way that we drive on the highway. We want to worship you with the way that we speak. We want to worship. God, everything we do, we want to worship. God, everything we do, we want you to be pleased with. Every bit of our life, God, we want it to worship. One more time. To worship you, I live. To worship. Have your way with us. Help us to fulfill our purpose. May our life be a life of honor and glory to you. May nothing be more important to us than you. Help us to turn away from the appetites and turn away from the emotion and turn away from the ego so we can stay in our gardens, so we can stay in that place of purpose. And for those of us who've made a few mistakes like myself, may we walk with our head held high knowing that I've been kicked out some stuff, but I'm still covered.
Yes, God.
Hold on for a second, Chosen to Worship. This just hit me. When I said kicked out but still covered, I remember, this is embarrassing, but I'll share it with you. When I was kicked out of school, I had got caught with like 70 some odd guns on campus and they wasn't having that. I mean, petty. And when I said kicked out, but still covered, it was like God spoke to my spirit. You know what, Unique? When I cover you, even though I kicked you out, when I bring you back, you'll be better. Because I got kicked out of that school like a few weeks before I was going to graduate. And so like over a decade later, I went back and got the degree. And that's not the good part. A couple years after that, they inducted me into Georgia Southern Top 40 Under 40 alumni. And I was talking to one of the teachers, and we were laughing because I'm probably the only person to be kicked out of school and then awarded with a Top 40 Under 40 alumni. And I say that not to bring myself glory, but just to remind you that no matter what you've been kicked out of, God has got you covered. So if the relationship didn't work out, he can bring you a better boo. If the job didn't work out, you left with five figures, you can come back with six. Yeah, whatever he kicked you out of, God said, just remember, I got you covered. And if you just submit to me, I can bring you back, but I won't bring you back the same way. I'll bring you back better. I'll use your testimony to bring me glory. I'll bring your hurt to help others. I'll use that pain to bring me purpose. Is there anybody that's glad that even though you've been kicked out, that God will cover you, that even though you lost some stuff, God can take that loss and level you up? Listen, that's the kind of God we serve. He said, unique, remind them that they've been kicked out, but they don't even need to pout over the past. Some of y'all are pouting over your past, and you can't move out your present. But if you want to live a life of purpose, you got to let go of what you've been kicked out of. And remember that God can work all things out for good for those who love him and have been called according to his purpose. To worship you, we live. That's why we can't lose. Devron, that's why we can't lose, brother. Because he's got his name on the line. Stop telling people that God did it for you. He didn't do it for you, he did it for him. He did it for his glory. He did it because he's so good. God, we thank you for this celebration of purpose that I believe we just stepped in. God, we're praying for another level of purpose in our ministry. We're praying for another level of purpose in our marriages. We're praying for another level of purpose in our money. We're praying for another level of purpose in our community impact. We're praying for another level of purpose in our love and support of one another. We're praying for another level of purpose in everything we do. Because your name is on the line. God, we thank you. And all this we pray is in Jesus' name. Amen.
How you doing, Chosen? I hope you are being blessed by today's worship service. This is the part of our service where we get to honor God with our sacrificial giving. Chosen, I want to let you know how proud I am of you for your generosity during such problematic times. You are literally helping us feed the hungry and clothe the naked. And for that, I want to say thank you. If you would like to continue to be a part of something much bigger than yourself, you can give in three ways here at Chosen. The first way is through our website. You can give safely and securely at chosencsra.org. That is chosencsra.org. Or you can give safely and securely through our text to give. That number is 404-994-5258. Again, that number is 404-994-5258. And if you would like to give by check or cash, you can just drop that off with one of our hospitality members on your way out of the worship center at the end of service. Again, I want to let you know how proud I am of you as a ministry for all it is that you're doing to help bring purpose into the people of this community that need it the most. Thank you. And please enjoy the rest of the service.
Good evening, family. Wasn't that an amazing service we just had? Oh my goodness. I almost cried my lashes off, y'all. I almost cried them off. But before I let you go, I just want to give a quick testimony about Pastor Unique. Now, I know sometimes his J's may kind of fool us, the Nikes he wears and everything like that, but I want to let y'all know that even though this is a non-denominational church, we have a pastor who has an apostolic calling on his life. And for those of you who don't know what apostolic means, it means he is, from what God God sends wise master builders. A master builder, somebody who lays foundation for others to build upon. And as you know, here at Chosen, Chosen is a platform for others to stand on so that our gifts can be exposed in order to exalt God's name. So for me, as y'all know, some of y'all anyways, I do a lot of speaking. And this year I've been getting speaking gigs, and I had my biggest one in October. And the first thing I said, I was like, oh man, I gotta call Unique. I gotta let him know what's going on. And I talked to him, and he said, well, how much are you charging? I said, I'm gonna charge what I usually charge. And he was like, nah. He was like, nope. He was like, you gotta charge a little bit more than that. I said, well, I mean, he was like, listen. He told me to put, and I'm gonna be just completely transparent with y'all. He said, add $2,000 extra to it. And I was like, but he was like, nope. He was like, I'm gonna show you how to set it up. He showed me how to set it up. And by the grace of God, they accepted my proposal. And I was able to get the amount that I had actually proposed to him. Now, I say all that to say that when you're called to a particular ministry, especially a ministry like Chosen, that means you are subject to that leadership. And when you're subject to that leadership, you're also subject to the blessings that come along with obedience to that leadership. So whenever you are operating in your purpose, the Bible tells us that, you know, God gives us the vision that we should write it down. And when that vision comes, when the vision comes, it may tarry, but when it comes, it will not tarry, which means your gift uplifts that vision. Your gift is the one that helps you propel into that vision. So as you are cultivating, this year is Grow 2021, as you are cultivating your gift, as you're nurturing that gift. In 2022, whenever you have the opportunity to use that gift in order to propel yourself into that vision, if the first thought that comes to your mind is, I gotta call my pastor, listen, call him, because he's going to help you set up new grounds. He's going to help you take your gift to another level. So I just want to leave y'all with that today, because I'm telling y'all what, I would have never got to the level I'm at had I not been obedient to the leadership, obedient to what God has called me to, and obedient to the ministry that God has called me to here at Chosen. So with that, I want to thank y'all for coming here. I want us to go ahead and stand up. I'm going to do this right this time. And we are going to do our purpose pledge on a count of three. One, two, three. May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord